Sí, para visitar a mi abuela, pero probablemente vaya a California.
¿Tiene familia en California?
No, para la escuela.
College.
¿Colegio?
El colegio.
¿Cómo me llamas?
Sí. Voy a estudiar medicina.
Thank you.
morning, friends. Happy Sabbath and welcome to the White Rock Lake Seventh-day Adventist Church. We are so happy to have you here today. We want to welcome all of our regular members, everyone who is joining us via our live stream, and we especially want to welcome all of our visitors. Is there anyone here today that might be joining us for the first time? Please raise your hand. Hello. Everyone just wave. Hello, good morning. We're so happy to have you here today. At this time, if we could, we'd like to invite everyone to stand, greet your neighbor, wish them a happy Sabbath. Just take a few moments. Remember the Sabbath day, to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor, and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. And in thou shalt do no work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Let's pray. Father in heaven, as we stop, we thank you for this opportunity to be able to worship you today. We thank you for this hope that you have given us. And we thank you for your son, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the gospel message. And God, in light of that, we come together in this place that is called by your name to be able to worship you and to be able to lift you up on high and acknowledge you as the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. And God, there is no other God. And so we want to pray that truly you will help us to be able to focus upon you this morning in a special way, and that we will be able to respond to you even as we lift our praise and worship up to you. God, we ask a special blessing upon each and every person that is here with us in the sanctuary and joining us via our live stream. In Jesus' name we pray all these things, Father God. Thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Now we're going to sing our Sabbath song, Don't Forget the Sabbath.
Please stand as we sing our hymn 388, Don't Forget the Sabbath.
The wind, the best, it brings with We are going to get right into our announcements. I'll go as quickly as we can. We want to move the service along because we want to get to the message. All of our church, our calendar events are on the actual church calendar. They're at whiterocklakesda.org/events. If we have your contact information, we can put you on our e-newsletter and you will receive an email every single either Thursday or Friday, just alerting you as to what is coming up. Also, we have a text messaging system if you'd like to join that as well. As you exit, just tell one of the greeters and they'll just hand you a little card. And all we're going to ask for is just your name, your email, and your phone. We're not asking for any addresses. But that'll let you know what's up and coming. And, you know, if you ever forget, you could just log on to the website there and it'll tell you everything that's going on in the church. We are having a baptism. Amen? Amen. We are having a baptism. And it's not only for adults. It's also for children, for kids. We actually started last Sabbath with the adults, and I neglected to plan, but we had two children in there. And I remember that we were talking about doing simultaneous baptismal classes for the adults and the kids as well. So the adults started last Sabbath, and then July 2nd, next Sabbath, we will continue with the adult class, but the children will actually meet in room 207, and they'll start their first lesson. We already have teachers for those baptismal classes. So we encourage you to come. If you are considering baptism, it begins for the children, for the kids, on July the 2nd in room 207. And then it'll continue. And then the adults will continue on July the 2nd. Now, I know that we're running into holidays and things like that, and people take vacations. But we will find a way to get every single person that wants to study, we will find a way of getting lessons to you. If that means that we need to meet during the week, then so be it. We will find a way to do this. And we will actually have a baptism at the end of August. Okay, there are several people right now in the adult baptismal class that are wanting to get baptized, and praise God for that. So if you are considering baptism, it's not too late. Okay, so you will continue. The adults will continue next Sabbath, July 2nd, in room 214 at 3 p.m. And these are the topics that we will be covering. Victory over sin, we already did that last Sabbath. July 2nd will be why the law of God is still binding. The July 9th, the state of the dead. The 16th, why we keep the Sabbath. 7:23 is thy way, O Lord, is in the sanctuary. On the last Sabbath in July will be why we believe in prophecy and the spirit of prophecy. And on August the 13th, it'll be the second coming of Jesus Christ. And on August the 20th, it'll be the historicist method of interpretation. Thanks to all who participated in the homeless feeding last Sabbath. Let me tell you, I believe it was approximately like 100 degrees or 101 degrees last Sabbath, but a group of faithful people still went. Who went that was in here in this audience? Who went? Okay, thank you. I believe Nick and Phil also went last Sabbath, and we have evidence that you guys were actually out there. Okay, there they go. They were actually feeding the homeless in downtown Dallas. Praise God for that. Let me tell you that right now, if you're following any of the news, a lot of the food banks are low on food. And you know, this affects a lot of people, and specifically the homeless. You know, we wanted to be able to provide something for them. I will tell you personally, many times, and I've told this story to a couple of people, many times I've thought, oh, you know, we go and we help the homeless, and it's that one time. And, you know, I always felt guilty because I'm like, okay, well, what else are we doing for them, right? But we have to believe that even these one-time occasions when we go, whether it be on a schedule or every now and then, is actually providing a blessing to them. And it really is, because they're actually receiving food. I would like for us to do eventually more for them. However, I believe that when we do these random acts of kindness, well, they're not really random because we're being intentional, it really brings hope to this sector right now. So we will plan another homeless feeding realistically within the next 2 months. I'm trying to work with the coordinator on that, but you're all welcome to come to that. The White Rock Lake SDA Vegetable Gardening Group will continue tomorrow morning at 10 a.m., and that'll be at the Lake Highlands Community Garden. And the address, I believe, is on the bulletin, but they will be meeting at 10 a.m. They've been meeting, I think, for approximately 3 months now. And let me see, do I have it there? Where is it? Okay, it is at 7901 Goforth Road. 7901 Goforth Road. It's immediately north of White Rock Lake. When I went there like 2 or 3 weeks ago, they were growing collard greens, potatoes, radishes, squash, beets, corns, peas, and cilantro. That's being headed by Ray. Ray Walkup, and if you have any questions, you can give him a call. He will also be here in the audience as well. His phone number is also in the bulletin. So we welcome Scotty Mayer. He will be presenting three times a day for Divine Service, 11:15, and then 3 p.m. and 4:30 p.m. The order of the messages are on your bulletin. Tonight, we will have a young adult and singles night out. Now let me tell you that while we were praying there, somebody said, well, what if you're married? And I'm like, you're welcome as well, okay? And that'll actually be at 8:40, okay? Sundown is at 8:40. So we will meet there at the restaurant at Andalus Mediterranean Buffet. It's at 1601 North Central Expressway in Richardson, Texas. So we know that the sun is going down later in, during the summertime. So make sure you're there sharp if you wanna grab some food. There is a buffet line, so it's pretty quick as you go through the line. North Dallas Adventist Academy Community Orchestra will be with us next Sabbath, July 2nd. Last time that they were here, they played some very beautiful sacred orchestral music, and they will be here next Sabbath. We will have a church business meeting, and that time has been moved to 5 p.m. because of the activities that we're having during the day with the baptismal classes. So it is very important that specifically church members be there, Sabbath, July 9th, 5 p.m., and it'll be at the Fellowship Hall, where we will discuss how the church is progressing. We'll discuss the finances of the church and what are the continued plans for the church. You are welcome there. Choir practice will be Sabbath, July the 16th, 2 p.m. in room 208. The men's prayer ministry is every other Sabbath. Today they do not meet, but the next time that they meet, that should say July 2nd, actually. July 2nd and then July the 16th. Your Heart's Journey, a women's retreat, will be in September, and all the information for that is in the church bulletin. And remember that your church needs you. We still need help with teachers for children, juniors, and early teen. We need some greeters, potluck coordinators, audiovisual setup, and audiovisual coordinators as well. Remember, the load gets a lot lighter when it's a group effort, when everybody's helping each other, helping us set up the audiovisual, running the kitchen, running Sabbath schools, etc. So if you have a desire to help, please alert one of us. There's several leaders here. And if you want to work, there is work to be done. Remember that the work that you do here, as insignificant as you might think it is, it's actually blessing somebody for eternity. So think about that when you volunteer. And we will have our baptism on Sabbath, August the 27th at 4 p.m. And we will be having it at the Richardson Seventh-day Adventist Church. We usually borrow their baptistry there when we have a baptism. So all are welcome to come and support the new members that will be coming. It is now time for tithes and offerings.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to see y'all. Today's tithe and offerings is for the Texas Vision. The reading today is from Matthew 6:20 through 21. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. We worship God by using our resources because it is the most secure placement. The Bible reveals that in the end, the elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. 2 Peter 3:10. Possessions will be of no value. These events will represent the most severe recession, hyperinflation, depression ever experienced by humanity. Peter invites his readers not to take these things lightly, but to undergo some fundamental changes. What kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives. 2 Peter 3:11. We can learn something from those who had to cope with hyperinflation. In the time of inflation, prices could double in less than 24 hours. In some places, individuals would go to the grocery store carrying cash in a basket over their heads. Worried and angry people would line up for hours in front of banks to withdraw their savings, only to hear request denied. As a result, the population and investors would lose faith in the local currency. Many would try to exchange their money into stronger currencies as a survival strategy. Some countries would exchange their devalued currency for new currency or start using foreign currencies locally. Exchange is the key strategy. This corresponds with the admonition of Jesus, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, Matthew 6:20. How can one do this exchange effectively? No need to go through the black market. To do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. This is the path revealed by the Apostle Paul. 1 Timothy 6:18. This week, as we worship with our tithe and regular offerings, we have another opportunity to exchange our perishable resources by being a blessing to others. Will the ushers please come forward? Let us pray. Dear gracious and sovereign Heavenly Father God, I come before your throne with thanksgiving and praise. You alone are holy and worthy of adoration. Thank you, Father God, for each person that is here today. Thank you for providing jobs. Father God, but most importantly, thank you that we have security in you and your Son, Jesus Christ. Father God, the gifts that you give us, or so that we in turn help each other, help others, to tell others about you and your Son, Jesus. Father God, that is the best gift that we could ever have, is the freedom that you give us to choose, to freely choose your Son Jesus as our Savior. Thank you so much for your faithful provisions. Thank you so much, Father God, for all the things that you do, from the small to big things. Father God, you bless us with resources, Father God. And we freely and we cheerfully and we happily give back, Father God, because it's going into your kingdom to help your people, to save lives, to save souls, Father God, for your kingdom. I give you all the honor, the glory, and the praise. In Jesus' holy and mighty name I pray. Amen.
Does anybody need a tithe or offerings envelope? Okay. Okay, so everybody has, if they want to give, they have an envelope. Okay, very good.
Gonna have an object lesson.
I'm gonna show something.
Okay. Now, can anyone tell me what's in this box? Gabby? Let's go check if there's cereal inside the box. I have a bowl in here. I guess I will hold it. And you will pour it.
Can you pour it?
Crayons. Oh,
crayons. It's crayons inside this box.
What happened? Allison, did you put some crayons in this cereal? Angelica, did you? No. Crayons in here, but anyway, well, we'll try the other box. I have another one in here. Let's try. Oh, it sounds like cereal. Okay, you want to try?
I do.
Okay. You can hold it, the bowl, and then you can open it, and then you can pour it. Angelica, can you let her sit on your side next to you? Allison, can you let the other one sit next to you? Here. You can sit. Okay, finally, we got a real cereal. Anyway, well, it says, the lesson of this now, it says, sometimes things are not really as they appear to be, and we can't be sure that our eyes and ears are truly seeing and hearing things the way they are. There is one thing we can always be sure of, and that is God's love for each one of us, for each one of you and me. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 11:1 that faith is to be sure of the things that we have not seen. God is as sure as the box of the breakfast cereal,
just like this one.
Because it's real, it's cereal in a box. A box of cereal, it's real cereal inside. Anyway, when you have faith in God, you can trust Him and believe that He will always take care of you. That's our object lesson for today. So who would like to pray?
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for dying on the cross for us. Forgive us for our sins and help us to have a good day today. And help people be safe and lead us to the right path. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Before we go back to our seats, can we do the offering?
Thank you. have their purse? One of the little... All right, good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. All right, it's wonderful to see everyone here this morning. So, I have a question for everyone. Who likes cookies, ice cream, or cake? Okay. It's honesty. Yes, it's okay. It's a safe space. All right, now who knows how to be temperate with those things? I saw one hand creeping up too. Okay. Oh, who knows how to be temperate? Can you hear me? Is that okay? So if you don't know how to be temperate, you have trouble with it, this health spotlight is for you. It's going over temperance. And it's number 5 out of the New START 8 health laws. So first, what is the meaning of the word temperate? Webster says, keeping or held within limits, not extreme or excessive, showing self-control. Though angry, he used temperate language. Did you know overeating causes impaired brain function, drowsiness, and heartburn? When you overeat food, you will have no energy for anything other than digesting unneeded food as excess fat. However, if you change your eating habits, you will regain energy and you will also be able to get a better night's rest and lessen the chances of developing high cholesterol and type 2 diabetes. The same goes for intemperance and overworking. Even too much of a good thing can be bad for you. Too much water, too much sunlight, too much nutritious food, it all has to be done in moderation. 4 ways to detoxify yourself after you've been binge eating. Number 1, drink lots of water. Drinking water is the best way to flush toxins out of vital organs. Since you may have consumed excess sodium found in junk or fried foods, your body may get dehydrated, which makes it even more important to increase your water consumption. Number 2, start exercising. It's understandable to miss a few workouts here and there, or lose track of your fitness goals. You can start with mild exercises, but be consistent with it. Choose simple exercises such as jogging and walking. Number 3, add metabolism boosting drinks to your regimen. The consumption of lemon and honey water early in the morning stimulates your digestive system and boosts your metabolism. Honey helps to soothe the digestive tract and also helps fight infectious diseases in the stomach. You can also try detox teas such as chamomile and ginger. Number 4, add some green leafy vegetables. We all can do this. We all need more vegetables, such as cabbage, broccoli, kale, spinach, and others that are rich in antioxidants and can help fight inflammation in the body. Also add tomatoes in your diet. The antioxidants help to detoxify you as well. These vegetables help in reducing bloating and cleansing of the gastrointestinal tract. You can either boil or steam 2 cups of spinach along with curry leaves and tootsie and add a pinch of salt, or you can strain it and simply drink it. This is a quote coming from Ellen G. White. The first one is Testimonies to the Church, and it's 491, and it says, "The controlling power of appetite will prove the ruin of thousands. When if had conquered on this point, they would have had the moral power to gain the victory over every temptation of Satan. But those who are slaves to appetite will fail in perfecting Christian character. The continual transgression of man for 6,000 years has brought sickness, pain, and death as its fruits. And as we are near the close of time, Satan's temptation to indulge appetite will be more powerful and more difficult to overcome." And the second quote is coming out of Council on Diets and Foods, and it's in chapter 1. "Our danger is not from scarcity, but from abundance. We are constantly tempted to excess. Those who would preserve their powers unimpaired for the service of God must observe strict temperance in the use of his bounties, as well as total abstinence from every injurious or debasing indulgence. This rising generation are surrounded with allurements calculated to tempt the appetite, especially in our large cities. Every form of indulgence is made easy and inviting. Those who, like Daniel, refuse to defile themselves will reap the reward of their temperate habits.
With their greater physical stamina and increased power of endurance, they will have a bank of deposit upon which to draw from in emergency. Right physical habits promote the mental superiority, intellectual power, physical strength, and longevity depend upon immutable laws. There is no happen so, no chance about this matter. Nature's God will not interfere to preserve men from the consequences of violating nature's laws. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 9:25, and every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. Have a happy Sabbath.
Good morning, church. Let's try one more time. Good morning, church. Praise God. Praise God. The Wild Rock Lake SDA choir is going to be singing He Knows My Name. I hope you enjoy the music.
Oh. invite everyone to kneel down if you can to pray.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Please bless us, O Lord. Please keep us safe as we're going through our days. Please let the sick to be healthy and the poor to have money, O Lord. Please bless us, O Lord. Please keep us safe, O Lord. And bless us, O Lord. Please keep us safe from any harms and dangers, O Lord. And we know that you're mighty and powerful, O Lord. So please bless us, O Lord. Send your angels to watch over us the whole day, O Lord. Thank you for this day. Amen.
Church family, please stand for scripture reading. Today's scripture reading comes from Romans 12, verse 2. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Thank you.
It's a joy and an honor to be back in your church. I can remember the last time that I came to visit your church was a hard time in my life. For those of you that remember the last time I came, I was getting on an airplane to come over here to Dallas, and I had worked on a particular piece of property for our ministry for about 6 months. And I was very excited about this piece of property. I had my heart dead set on it. And that Friday, as soon as I got on my airplane, I got a text message that basically said it wasn't going to work out. And let me tell you, God is so merciful. He's so amazing because what I thought that I wanted, God ended up providing something infinitely better and gave our ministry something that I didn't even realize I needed at a fraction of the cost. And to this date, our ministry has had its first home, and the second that we opened those doors, the entire thing was paid for, and I didn't owe a dime on the building. So, God is definitely in control, and when you let him be in control, it is amazing at how much he will actually give you things that you don't even realize you wanted. I have to ask for your prayers. When I got on the airplane again this time, I don't know what it is about Dallas, but I all of a sudden sat back in my chair and I realized You know that feeling that you get when you know you're getting sick? And you know, like, your skin feels a little bit chilly? And I leaned my head against the side of the airplane and I just said, oh Lord, have mercy. I spent most of the night last night coughing, and I took enough DayQuil to tranquilize a small horse this morning. So I ask for your prayers that I will be able to deliver these messages, and that this will be a blessing to you guys as well. I feel very passionate about some of the things that I'm going to share with you. And before I get started, I would love to bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, it is always amazing to me that you take a broken vessel such as myself, and Lord, you have a message that you want this church to hear this weekend. And so, Lord, I just ask that you use me as broken as I am, Lord, but use me as your mouthpiece. May there be something that is said here today that give us a clearer picture of what it is that you are desiring of us, how you want us to live our lives, and perhaps some changes that we maybe need to make. And so, Lord, I just thank you for each and every opportunity. I thank you for each and every soul that is here this morning. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. As I was considering putting this message together, I want to give you a little reason why I feel called to actually talk about this topic. We live in a pretty crazy world, do we not? I mean, this last week, I was shown a bill that was signed over by our president in the topic of homosexuality that was limiting what we call conversion therapy. And when I saw what this bill was actually labeled as and named, and also some of the elements that were inside of this bill, one of the things that was popped up in there was prayer. And I thought it was very interesting that it is becoming and will become illegal to pray for someone to change their ways. I hope you guys realize where we are in the wake of time. Our culture is permeating so much of our everyday lives. I see over and over and over again, many times, culture becomes one of our dominating elements that we operate by, and Christianity sometimes takes second place. Lord, have mercy. Because as I notice how the culture is trying to redefine who you are, what your identity are, even basic biological things about you, the culture is trying to shape us in a way that I believe is contrary to the Word of God. I had a young lady show up in our office this last week, and she has been impacted by our ministry. She's 17 years old. And she went to a Adventist convention over this past week. And she has involved herself in the youth groups and the youth rooms. And one of the topics that was heavily discussed in the youth group was one of the movies that has come out recently about Doctor Strange. And the youth pastor was talking about how this week it was going to be released on Disney Plus, and they were really excited to go and watch Doctor Strange, and they were talking about this. You guys, I spend 95% of my time running around and trying to teach and educate and talk with the youth of our church. And many times we are divorcing our connection of of Christianity and the culture around us. And so that's why I felt passionate about discussing this topic with you here this morning that I want to share. My goal is to not offend you. My goal is to not have you walk away with, why did you just show me this? My goal is to simply make you think, why are you a Christian? What does it mean to actually be a Christian? When you say I am a follower of Christ, what does that actually mean in your life? Because if we don't have a problem with some of the things that our culture is pushing upon us in the world today, and we have no problem engaging or watching some of these absolutely evil things in the world, then there's a problem. I spoke in a church in Albuquerque a few weekends ago, and I'm going to pick on Dr. Strange because I asked the church, how many of you in this church have watched Dr. Strange? I almost took my phone out and took a photograph. 75% of the entire room raised their hand. What I notice is not something that's getting better. What I notice is it's getting more and more and more frequent. And so it is my prayer that what is said to you this morning will resonate with you in some way, shape, or form. You will somehow think of the life that you are living and the interactions that you have with other people. Is it really, truly a follower of Christ? I want to read to you a couple of Bible verses. Romans 10:9 says, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I love how sometimes the Bible is so simple to understand. And sometimes we overcomplicate things with so much of trying to understand this or that. When I read a verse like this, I say, wow, that seems relatively simple. I believe Jesus is Lord. And I confess him with my lips. But I want to share something with you. Matthew 5, 8 and 9 says, these people honor me with their lips, but with their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain, and their teachings are mere human rules. It is not enough in today's world to simply say, I am a follower of Christ, and then I have no problem with the evil media of the world. We know that Matthew 7, 22 through 23 says, many will say in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out demons in your name? Have we not done many wonders in your name? These are not a class of people who don't understand the things of God. They understand about God. They're telling people about God. They're running around and prophesying of things that will come. This is not a class of people who do not understand. Yet they hear these awful, awful words. I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. What does it mean to be lawless, to not follow the laws, the Ten Commandments, right? You remember the rich young ruler? He came and he asked about the Ten Commandments. And even when the Pharisees asked him, which is the best of the law? Jesus answered and said, love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. All of them are comprised with that. So what exactly is lawlessness? It's something that's different than that. It's not seeing your brother in that loving light. It's not doing things for others, right? 1 John 2, 3 through 6 says, we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. Whoever says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in that person. But if anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. You see, I see a difference. I see a difference of somebody that claims, I know what the Bible says, I know what the truth says. The reason I'm sharing this with you is I went to a convention recently, and I was speaking on the topic of superheroes. And as I sat down for lunch, there was a gentleman that came and he sat down with me, and he put his lunch down, and the first thing he said out of his mouth is, I don't believe anything you have to say. And I said, okay, Lord, not my fight, your fight. And I just listened to the man. And he said, I go to church all the time. I read my Bible all the time. I don't think by me going and watching a movie is going to dislodge my understanding of God. That may be true. And as I listened to the man speak, I said, Lord, what is it that you want me to say? I don't have anything to say to him, but you do. What do you want me to say? And all of a sudden, God popped an idea in my head. And I asked him one simple question. What if God told you not to watch those movies? And he sat and he ate his lunch and he kind of looked up and he said, you know what? I'd watch them anyway. And I said, the movies aren't your problem. The idea that you want to do whatever it is that you want to do because you want to do it, regardless or irrespective of what God wants you to do, that's a heart problem. There's a difference between intellectually understanding what God is asking from us and all of a sudden doing what God is asking of us. I've asked this question many times in our church and with our young people. Do you think witchcraft is a good thing? Do you think sorcery is a good thing? Pretty much everyone in our church will agree with you, it is not a good thing. It is a bad thing. How do you know it's a bad thing? Because the Bible speaks expressly against it. Let me ask you a question, church. Remember, it's the Sabbath and you have to tell the truth. How many of you have seen something with witchcraft in it? That's a majority of the room. There's a difference between intellectually understanding what God is asking of us and all of a sudden doing what God is asking of us. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates his brother or his sister is still in darkness. Anyone who loves his brother or sister lives in the light, but there is nothing to make them stumble. But anyone who hates his brother or sister is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness, and they do not know where they're going because the darkness has blinded them. I share this with you because I want to show you something that was very interesting to me. There was a documentary that was made on some MMA fighters. And these MMA fighters started a thing called Fight Church, and it was basically some pastors that wanted to engage in MMA-style fighting. And on the poster it says, Punch Thy Neighbor, Fight Church. In fact, this was an Academy Award-winning film. It came out on Netflix. I'm going to play a little clip from this film, and I want to show you something, and I want to show you how interesting this is, because we live in a day and age where we go, I understand that the Bible is telling me to love my neighbor, but I can still be a Christian, and I can punch their lights out.
Send it to whatever side you have here. God, you have called us to a fight.
When Preston came up with the idea of having a fight club in the church, it was an easy thing to say yes to. Tough guys need Jesus too.
You guys like to see me fight another pastor?
We'll just be a couple of God-fearing men punching each other in the face.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Pastor versus Pastor.
Tonight, we gotta fight. And then we'll talk about Jesus tomorrow when we go to church.
You get the idea. Do you see a stark contrast of going, this doesn't make any sense? Do you see that? And I want to put this out there because I want you to think about this. There's even probably a majority in this room that don't have a problem watching MMA. But when you see it in this kind of context and you say, this is a fight against my brethren and I'm supposed to be loving my brethren, this makes no sense. Can I share with you a real story? I'm very hard on superheroes because I understand where they come from. They're ancient Greek and Roman gods. You can look this up on your own time. There's enough evidence out there that these are other gods. The Bible is very clear, very specific. Have no other gods before me. And I had a gentleman that watches our ministry, and he contacted us one day, and he said, I have a ministry as well. I have a YouTube channel, and I like to discuss things about God, but I actually talk very, very much about superheroes. Would you be willing to come on my show? And so one of the other colleagues of mine and I, we went on his channel, and I'll tell you, I've studied this for 10 years. I've walked around and had many conversations with young people about superheroes. So I came armed to the teeth in this YouTube channel going, I'm going to share with this person, and I'm literally going to load up my AK-47 with truth bombs, and I'm going to drop them on him and his audience. And when he asked me, why is it that you do what you do? And I shared with him, I launched into this big long thing because I grew up a Christian and I went to Hollywood and I spent 10 years there and all of a sudden I got lost in that world and God won my heart back and now I'm running around in churches and trying to teach people about the dangers of Hollywood and blah, blah, blah. I went on this big long thing about it. And one of my other ministry colleagues, he said, well, why did you get involved in this? And he said, oh, I went into the occult, and all of a sudden I was hating on God, and all of a sudden God won a hold of my heart, and I came back in, and I was influenced by this ministry, and now we want to go around and we want to teach people about this. And the gentleman was just listening to us tell our stories on why we were working for God. Mind you, he was wearing a Spider-Man hat, a Marvel t-shirt. There was a whole entire Marvel Universe thing behind him. And he said, I want to tell you why I'm doing what I'm doing. And he raised his right hand, and his hand was withered. And he said, I had a stroke when I was 2 months old, which left me no feeling in the right side of my body. I've had dozens of surgeries over the years. In fact, I had metal legs all growing up. My friends made fun of me. No one wanted to be my friend. When I got into high school, he said I was so made fun of that I literally did not want to live my life anymore. He was thrown out of a two-story building, and he literally said, I want nothing else in this world. He loved comics, obviously, naturally so, because you could see why he didn't have the physical stature that most people have, and he gravitated towards something more than in this world, and he came to the place that he was going to commit suicide. And he said, God, if you're real, you have to show me right now, because I don't have much time left. And right then, God spoke to his mind, and he had a Spider-Man comic open up on his table. And he said he flipped through the pages of that Spider-Man comic, and God showed him this war between God and Satan in that Spider-Man comic, and he said that it was enough to get him to want to have a relationship with God. And he he said, I love your ministry. He said, I've watched all your videos. I agree with you. In fact, I don't tell people to watch or engage in comic books. But he said, I'll tell you what. I wanted to start a ministry that I could reach kids that would never, ever turn on your video. They would never listen to you or watch anything that you put out. And he goes, I'm reaching these kids with the only means that I have, and that's using this. And I'll tell you what, it was like the Holy Spirit just went, listen to him, just listen to him. You know what I realized out of that experience? Do I really care about people? Do I really love people the way Jesus loves them? Or am I more worried about sharing truth because it's truth? And I went, Lord, have mercy on me. Because I feel like sometimes this kind of a thing where I would look at this and I would go, that's ridiculous. That's so far from me. But yet I'm so willing to engage with my brethren and try to battle them. You guys, do you see your brethren through the lens of Jesus? Do you? So many people are so willing to share truth no matter what the cost is. And I don't see that's how Jesus did it. Jesus wasn't a compromiser of truth. But there was a way that he got to people's hearts. Psalms 11:5 says that the Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked and those who love violence, he hates with a passion. Some versions say his soul hates. And that's an interesting concept to me, that God would actually hate something, because when I read my Bible, I see time and time again how much love God has for us. So when I hear something that says God hates this thing, my ears perk up, because God is so loving. Think about that when you think of the media that you watch. If it has nothing but guns, killing, shoot, fighting, beating up and stuff, is that really what God wants us to see each other as? Even Richard Dawkins, who was a voice in our world against Christianity, he wrote a book called The God Delusion. And he says, I'm against religion because it teaches us to be satisfied with not understanding the world. Now, I think that's an absolute wrong statement, because I think one of the only logical things that helps us understand the world is this book. It helps us to understand why things are the way that they are, why people treat each other the way that they do. But even look at Richard Dawkins. Listen to what he says.
I'm not one of those who wants to stop Christian traditions. This is historically a Christian country. I'm a cultural Christian, the same way as many of my friends call themselves cultural Jews or cultural Muslims. So yes, I love singing carols along with everybody else. I'm not one of those who wants to purge our society of our Christian history.
So even here, someone that does not believe in God says, I'm a Christian. I subscribe to Christian morals and Christian ideas. Isn't that interesting that we can call ourselves Christian, yet we don't see much of the fruit of what it means to be a Christian in some of the world? I don't know if you recognize these two gentlemen here, but their names are Rhett and Link, and they are some of the top YouTubers out there. They used to be evangelical teachers. In fact, they both were teachers in an evangelical school, and they were the leaders for many, many years. They recently came out as deconstructing their faith. They don't believe in God at this point. How is that possible that you can teach the the Bible, be engaged in that, those kind of activities for so long, and then come to the conclusion that none of this is real. How is that possible? Listen to what he says as Rhett is talking about his experience of coming to this conclusion. And he's talking about it took him years to come out and publicly state this. And so he's reading a journal that he wrote back in 2014. Listen to what he says.
This is from 2014. Okay? I understand that it is unreasonable to expect Christianity to be a set of scientifically verifiable principles. It is a faith, implying that some sort of believing without seeing is involved. And more specifically, Christianity is a relationship with Jesus, and relationships are not well defined or experienced scientifically. However, I don't think it insignificant that the deeper I have dug into Christianity with a thirst for the truth, the more difficult it has become to have faith. In fact, for me, it has become impossible. You see, I kind of saw Christianity as this boat in a very stormy sea. It's stable. There's a lot of other people on it. It's got a destination. You're going to get through this. It gives you something to hold on to. It gives you stability. It gives you purpose. It gives you direction. And it gives you community. And when I jumped ship, I didn't jump to another boat. I jumped into the water. And I pulled my wife and my children in with me. I jumped into a sea of uncertainty. And that's where I've lived for about 6 years.
Even his wife and his children, can you imagine? Can you imagine on that great day that someone like this with millions and millions of followers could have such a voice for God, could have such a platform to teach people about God, threw it all away for what? He even understands that he went into a sea of uncertainty, and he said when he came home and he told his wife that he didn't believe in God anymore, she immediately burst into tears because she understood the ramifications of what he was saying. And to this day, his wife and his children have nothing to do with God. How is that possible? A friend of theirs was remembering back into an experience and said, I remember when Link's story from high school, when he got drunk and the night previous upon Link's confession of Rhett, Rhett stopped the car and said, get out. His reaction was dripping with cultural Christian legalism. Because his first thought was Jesus wouldn't have demanded me to get out of the car because of failure, shaming him in that process. Isn't this isn't the Christ I see in the Bible at all. All of the guilt felt like the younger years seemed to be as a result of what he thought about cultural Christianity, not biblical Christ, not the biblical Christ. Soon both of them know all the Christian slang terms and cliches, but I didn't really hear anything that made me think about their relationship with the living God through Jesus Christ. It much more seemed like a relationship with Southern cultural Christianity that looks down on its nose upon sinners and spreads the guilt rather thickly if you fall out of line. The reason I wanted to share this story with you is we have to make a connection with Jesus. We have to make a connection with Christianity in a way that it affects our lives. Because all of a sudden, if we're sitting in church and we have no problem with the things of this world, and they're not the same, this is the result of that kind of thinking. In our mingling in society and families and whatever relationships, life we are placed, either limited or extended, there are many ways in which we may acknowledge our Lord and many ways which we may deny him. We may deny him in our words and speaking evil of others, by foolish talking, jesting, or joking, by idle or unkind words, by prevaricating, speaking contrary to the truth, In our words, we may confess Christ is not in us, and in our character, we may deny him by loving our ease, by shunning the duties and burdens of life which someone must bear if we do not. And by loving sinful pleasure, we may also deny Christ by the pride of our dress or the conformity to the world or by the uncourteous behavior. We may deny him by loving our own opinions and seeking to maintain and justify self. We may also deny him in allowing our mind to run the channel of the lovesick sentimentalism and brood over our supposed hard lots and trials. That's counsels to our church. You know, many of us have never thought of, I would never deny Christ. But what she's counseling us is be careful, because we may deny Christ in a variety of ways in our lives. Satan thought that he would have the whole world on his side, and today the enemy is still playing the game of life with everyone. He seeks to bring in division and dissension. His goal is to divide and conquer us. And as we see our church, are we not divided more than anything ever before? I got a message in our office this last week, and we had mentioned some things about Dr. Strange. He had used some hand symbols that were clearly demonic hand symbols. And we'd mentioned that in one of our videos. And all of a sudden, another ministry colleague of mine who has nothing to do with evil things whatsoever. In fact, he had a video where he was diving and he was talking about these illustrations of diving in caves. And this brother decided to call him up and say, I saw in your video that you used the hand symbol of the devil, and I cannot have anything to do with your video. And you know what? It dawned on me. Are we dividing? Are we constantly looking to find fault in instead of encouraging the brethren? We're sitting there like trying to pick apart. You didn't do this right. You didn't do that right. Rather than, hey, praise God, you made a video that actually had some great little points in it. And I got some friends that I could send that to. Think about that. Think about that. Are we causing division in our own ranks? But if we're partakers of the divine nature, we will stand united as a whole. Let us not think that our churches can enjoy God's blessing while in a state of disunion. In this world, there are representatives of Christ, and He's called us to glory and to virtue. He has represented the Father, so we are to represent him to the world. Can you imagine when people come and visit our churches and they see some battles going on inside the church? Many times, those people that are coming in for the first time may not come back again. They're waiting and looking for some reason to say, yep, I knew I shouldn't have been there. Do you welcome new visitors with open arms? Do you encourage the pastors? We deny him when we have a selfish spirit, criticizing our brethren. We deny him in seeking to be first, in seeking to honor one another. We may deny Christ in outward appearance by gratifying a proud heart and by lifting up a soul to vanity or uncourteous behavior. You know, are we truly displaying that inward Christian fruit? Hillsong was, many of you have probably heard Hillsong songs over the years. They sing them in many churches. They did a documentary on them recently. And it's not a shocker that many of the things that go on behind these doors are awful, awful things. And awful, awful treatment of women and misuse of the money and all kinds of things, right? But isn't it interesting that we sing their songs and we play their music? If we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of truth, there remains no sacrifice for sins. If you know that God is specifically speaking to you, this is not an activity to engage in, and you still go home and engage in that activity. Brothers and sisters, the Bible is clear. What more can God do? If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven and I will forgive and I will heal their lands. I am first and foremost desiring of everyone to come to a knowledge of God. And I can't wait to get to heaven and to hear the stories of some of the most amazing transformations that God has had. And when I saw Kanye West have his transformation, this was a man in the world stage that was extremely blasphemous against God, extremely against the things of God. And when he came around, there was many people that were like, yes, God can reach anyone's heart. He can go any, turn around anyone. And I too was like, I hope and pray that God got a hold of his heart. Did you know that when Kanye West made his album, Jesus is King, did you know that no other artist has ever had this many number one songs on the charts? So many number one songs from the same album. He's the only artist to be able to have done that. Some of the other artists had maybe one or two or three. And I was so hopeful that what he was doing was something beautiful. And of course it looks strange. Of course there are some things that you're like, well, they're a celebrity, and you dismiss it as this is quite odd. The clothing that everybody wears, maybe the formation that they're in. But I want to show you something very interesting that was shown to me. This is one of the things that he does when he calls his Sunday service together. And he had everybody dressed in these white robes. So I started digging around on the internet about white robes. And I found that on October 31st, there was a pagan ceremony by the Druids that would get together and they would worship on October 31st. And what they would wear is these white robes. And so as I started Googling all these worship ceremonies from Druids, it dawned on me that they all were meeting in these circular things, and so was Kanye West. In fact, why did Kanye West do his Sunday service on October 31st in the same manner that they would do these worship ceremonies? Literally, I mean, it's like exactly a carbon copy of that. Why would he do that? Could it be sheer coincidence? Well, brothers and sisters, we're engaged in a mighty war. And there is an incredible amount of people caught in this war. 2 Timothy 3:4 says that the end time will be people who are lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. And today, more than anything else, we have so many things that we think are fun. More things than we can possibly ever imagine. We've made gods out of everything from musicians to actors to all sorts of things. Martin Luther said this: whatever your heart clings to and confides in, that in reality, really, is your God. And like I told you about the gentleman that sat down and he said, I can't listen to a word that you're saying, and I would still watch these movies because it's not going to change my heart. Is there something in your life that you're clinging to today? That if God told you you shouldn't be involved in that, are you willing to give that to God? John Calvin said the human heart is an idol factory. and the devil has played upon this time and time again. I was curious in the Bible when the Israelites were constantly getting tripped up by this god Baal. They were constantly following after Baal and they were willing to give up their allegiance to God. God had done some amazing things for the Israelites and they knew the stories. So what was it about this god Baal? And as I started to look up on the internet, what is Baal? Why were people so fascinated with this god? He was called the God of the heavens and they called him the Lord, Lord. In fact, they said that he was the one who came in the clouds and he was the one who is called the Lord of the heavens. And it was told that Baal was the one that made the sun come out and made the plants grow. And it was Baal that made all the world. And I said, you know what? That's kind of a parallel to God, right? And as I started to read on, it said that Baal had an arch enemy. And his arch enemy is a snake god named Mot. And this snake god was from the underworld, and he was the god of death. And so it was told in their folklore that Baal came from the heavens down to fight this snake god, and the snake god ended up winning, and all of a sudden, Baal dies, then Baal was resurrected back to life. Now, where in this story do you not see a parallel for God? You see, we look at the stories in the Bible and we say, wow, those people, they were so tripped up by all these ancient gods. They were so foolish, I would never be like that. But let me submit to you today, we're tripped up with all these same sort of distractions even today. As I began to read on, it said that the worship of Baal was popular in Egypt and the New Kingdom about 1400s BCE. And through the influence of the Arameans, who borrowed the Babylonian pronunciation Baal, they ultimately became known as the Greek Belos, identified with Zeus. So follow this logic. Baal, who was the god of the heavens, all of a sudden tripped up this nation and through time then got transformed in name and handed to that particular current generation as the god Zeus. And then that dawned on me. Do you know who Zeus is? Zeus is the god that lives in the heavens, right? And all of a sudden, Superman is Zeus. You see, the devil is so clever that he can take something that was literally making a people fall back here, and he goes, if I just change the name, and I just put some spandex on them, and I just transform them, I'll hand them to you today, and many people, many young people in our church, come to our religious meetings with the Superman shirt on. I've got nothing, no problem with Superman. And yet, if you just follow this line of logic, Superman is Baal. Are we still worshiping Baal in our churches and in our schools and all over the place? Because just like Baal, it's the God in the heavens. I see the story of Jesus. Clearly, God did not tell us to take that story and just pull out of it what you see in the great controversy. And I believe that's why 1 Timothy 4:7 gives us some very wise advice. Have nothing to do with irreverent and silly myths, but rather train yourself in godliness. You see, this verse gives us a little picture and a window into the problem that I see with a lot of superhero movies. You see, superhero movies are all about saving you, but saving you from what? They don't teach you anything about your moral or immoral self. It has nothing to do with your character. It has everything to do with saving you from destruction. You know, the devil would like to save you from destruction. In fact, that's why he rallies the troops around in Revelation 20 to fight against the city. He gathers Gog and Magog together to battle that great city of the God of Almighty. He wants to try to preserve life, but he has no interest in preserving your immoral self, or your moral self. 1 Kings 18:21 says Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord be him, God, follow him. If Baal is God, follow him." But the people said nothing. I ask you today, brothers and sisters, that if you struggle with some of these things, God is asking you today, how long are we going to stand in 2 feet in two worlds? I have yet to walk into a church and say, how many of you have seen this movie? And people just look and say, what? Why would I do that? Why would I even care to go and watch that? Jeremiah 51:44 through 45 says, "I will punish Baal in Babylon, and I will make him spew out what he has swallowed. The nations will no longer stream to him. Even the wall of Babylon will fall. Come out of her, my people, come out of her. Save your lives, each and every one of you, from the fierce anger of the Lord." You see, what God has asked of the ancient people is no different than what he's asking of us today. He's asking us to take a step out of the things of the world. We cannot stand with 1 foot in the church and 1 foot in the world. Revelation 18:4-5 says, "And I heard another voice saying, come out of her, my people. Don't be partakers of her sins, that you will receive her plagues. In fact, her sins have reached up into heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities." God takes it very serious. And so I want to bring this up, because my passion is for you young people in the room. And the reason why I really wanted to even put a little bit of element in this is because I hope and I pray, brothers and sisters, that something like this does not entice you at all. It's so dark and it's so full of evil things that it doesn't take a rocket scientist to even just barely scratch the surface. He's the master of black magic. That's the hero of the story, a black magic master. When you look up what black magic is in the Bible, it's a magic involving invocation of evil spirits for evil purposes. You see, there's not a separation between when I come to church, I come to church, but when I go out in the rest of the week, I can do different things than I learned in the church. Brothers and sisters, don't get tripped up by this. It's so dark and so satanic. You see upside down pentagrams. These are the things that baffle me. He's using tarot cards. And in all of these movies, they are literally just recreations of what the comic books are. And they're all about these evil and terrible things. And this particular Doctor Strange was so dark and alarming that even the trailer showed him, you can't see this right now because of the lights that are up here, but I'll tell you what you're seeing. In the trailer, he was having a repetitive dream. And over again, he has this dream. And it's this doorway that opens up. And when the doorway opens, you see a stairway to heaven. And he sees this as a nightmare. And here he sees himself in the world when there's a bunch of dead bones and destroyed bodies all over. And this is literally the time that he's like thinking of in this dream. And this is where the story takes place. You guys, this is the story of Satan himself. In this picture right here, you can't even quite see it. But this is inside of his room. There's a harp on the table right here. A harp. Who plays the harp in today's world? And the harp is dusty, and he doesn't pick it up anymore. They tell you exactly who these characters are. Do not get distracted by it's just fake and it's just make-believe, so therefore it has no bearing on my life whatsoever. His lair is called the Sanctum Sanctorium, the holiest of holies. This is so satanic, it's not even hiding the fact that it is 100% opposite of the things of God. There's even a scene in the movie where Dr. Strange turns water into wine.
Well, I'll eat this.
There's so many blasphemous things in these movies. Don't watch them. Don't engage in them, young people. Even if all of your friends go and see them, and it broke my heart this last week when this 17-year-old girl walked into our office and she said I was at this Adventist gathering. Adventist gathering, and all they can do is talk about they can't wait for Doctor Strange to come out on Disney Plus. You know, I shared with you about Kanye West. Did you know Kanye West's keyboardist is an Adventist? Did you know that? Did you know the guy that made Doctor Strange, Scott Dickerson? Did you know that he is a Christian? Did you know that? In fact, he's quite vocal about his Christian belief. It's nothing wholesome in those movies. You guys were standing on this thin red line between here and eternity. I've seen people, I've now worked in ministry long enough, I've seen people come and go, and I've seen people come into the Adventist church and are excited, and then all of a sudden they get pulled out, and it's breaking my heart. What is it that you didn't find here? What is it that you didn't see? What is it, young people, that you're searching for, that you're willing to walk away from this literally with, I don't want anything to do with this whatsoever. I live in Chattanooga, Tennessee, near Southern Adventist University, and I see young people all the time walking out of our church. In fact, that's one of the last few times that you'll get an opportunity to see the young people, and then many times they go off into the world and they are gone. What is it that we don't see? What is it that the value that we don't have here? Is it because we honestly are confused of what it means to be a Christian and why we do what we do? Do you know why I don't watch these movies? Do you know the real reason why? Because I love my God. I love my Savior so much. Why would I want to watch anything that he has cautioned me against in my Bible? And for you young people, I know the attraction is strong. I remember what it was like, but I'll tell you what, with the closer you draw to Jesus, the stranger the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. As we near time when principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places will be brought into warfare against the truth, when deceiving powers of Satan will be so great that it will be possible to deceive the very elect, we must have our discernment sharpened and by the divine enlightenment. We may know the spirit that is of God, and that we may not be ignorant of Satan's devices. Why I believe God has called our ministry to even speak about things like this in our church. As much as I would like to say it, not a problem. People don't struggle with this. We still struggle with these things all the time. Our young people are caught up in this. But you know what? God is not asking us to be ignorant of those things. He's given us enough information, and he's asking for us to be able to discern what spirit these things are coming from. Cruella de Vil was a movie that came out a few years back with Emma Stone, and this was the trailer, and so I screenshotted the trailer, and it says, "Who wants to be nice? Who wants to be nice? I want to be nice. I want to be loving towards my fellow man." And she says, "A life lived in penance, it just seems to be a waste. And the devil has much better taste. Where there's always a line, and if you read what it says right there, it says, Hell Hall, at the gates of hell. Her license plate on her car even says, the devil. But I go straight to the front of the line, because I dress this well. Beauty is the only thing that matters. Embrace the darkness and be reborn. That's simply what the trailer said. And you know what? I was giving this message up in Michigan. And as I was talking to the young people about this, a gentleman came up to me afterwards and he said, you know, Emma Stone's husband is an Adventist. Did you know that? Lord, have mercy. Have mercy to me. Have mercy to our young people. That we have lost our ability to discern things even like this. Disney is not hiding anymore. They put out a line of clothing, and I just want to highlight a couple of things. One of the pieces of clothing right here on the zipper says, Lose your soul. One of the clothing says, avoid the light. One of them says, one bite and all your dreams will come true. One of them says, regret, risk now, regret later. And one of them says, the bad witches club, why be a princess when you can be a queen? Don't support this stuff. We have to make a decision whether we want to order our lives after God or not. And let me tell you, this is a major struggle in our church. This is a comment that came into one of our videos. And I felt called to read this to you because I want you to see that this struggle is extremely real. This person says, so I got to see the new Harry Potter movie. And I know all these things, and I should avoid them altogether, but it's difficult, you know, not to know what comes next. But I saw this movie in a very different light. Maybe part to loving your content. So here's somebody that's watched a lot of our content. For instance, this movie, the villain obviously plays the God role, and he wants to wipe out anyone who doesn't follow him, who is not pure in his and not good in his opinion. There is an instance in order to prove right to rule, he kills the innocent magical lamb creature. And the music that is of a whore, he very much sacrifices it in a classical biblical way by slitting the throat and letting the blood run out on the rocks in the center of the courtyard area. And then he brings the lamb back to life. This is a Harry Potter movie, by the way. And it bows down to him and proves that by their law that he is pure and the best leader that everyone needs. But clearly the heroes plays the role of Satan, and they say that this is all just a charade. They say that the lamb has been tampered with and a zombie, and people don't deserve to die just because they won't follow him or his way. All of this takes place at the top of a high mountain peak structure where they choose who should rule. And in everybody that rebels against this moment, and a new lamb is proved who does not choose the villain. I'm somewhat embarrassed because I know these movies don't even need a hidden message as they glorify witches and wizards and magic and witchcraft itself, but their interesting themes is a charade. They say that the lamb has been tampered. Oh, I already read that. I'm somewhat embarrassed, but interesting themes nonetheless. God bless. Happy Sabbath. I know I should give these things up. This is not someone that does not know what the truth is. This is not somebody who is unaware of some of the truths that we hold in our church. But I wanted to share that with you because, brothers and sisters, this is a real struggle that people have, and I pray that it is not your struggle. And if it is, God can help you. I know he can, because he helped me. What are you doing, brethren, in the great work of preparation? Those who are united with the world are receiving the worldly mold and preparing for the mark of the beast. those who are distrustful of self and are humbling themselves before God and purifying their souls by obeying these truths are receiving the heavenly mold and preparing for the seal of God on their foreheads. When the decree goes forth and the stamp is impressed, the character will remain pure and spotless for an eternity. Now is this time to prepare. The seal of God will never be placed on the forehead of an impure man or woman. It will never be placed on the forehead of an ambitious, world-loving man or woman. It will never be placed on the forehead of men and women whose false tongue and deceitful hearts. All who receive the seal must be without spot before God. They must be candidates for heaven. You guys, now is the time to prepare. We know that a time is coming upon us that is never before, and we've spoken about it for 100 years in our church, and we say, Satan has had so many years to prepare for this, but let me tell you, if you can't even tell the difference between a good movie and a bad movie, how are you ever going to tell the difference when Satan has had 6,000 years to prepare for this? There's no way. We want to be prepared. But that preparation is in literally spending time at the feet of Jesus and asking him to cleanse and purify our hearts and minds. To renew our minds, like the scripture reading this morning. That is my prayer. Let us pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, help us not to be just cultural Christians. Help us not to be swayed by all the different winds of doctrine blowing every which direction at this hour. But Lord, help us to be able to be bold for you. To make decisions for you based upon the knowledge that you've given to us. To help us to not be swayed by friends or by the popularity of everybody else doing that thing. And Lord, it is my prayer that we hunger and we thirst after righteousness, and that we learn to be what it means to be a follower of Christ, so much so that anyone that observes our ways or has any interactions with us, they can't help but to be attracted to you. We thank you and love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Which is hymn number 604.
We know that we are.
Before we start exiting, we have just a couple of announcements. So we are about to have fellowship potluck, and we do have enough food for absolutely everybody. Just remember that when we go through the line the first time, we go lightly to make sure that everybody's served, and then when there's food left over, which there always usually is,